All right, so today we're going to write some blog posts based on what we've talked about previously. Let me give you this checklist that I've put together about the basic three stages of a blog post. And so on your computers here, go to the desktop and then go to the computer window at the top left. So go ahead and open up computer. And then we will open the network location, classroom data Z, open that. And then scroll down to my folder called Campus Blogging. Scroll down. And I've got a new item here. You want to drag this to your desktop. Campus Blogging WordPress Checklist. So drag that to your desktop to get a copy. You can print it after I turn the printer on during the break. You can email it to yourself. But let's open it and let's look at it together, and we'll talk about it in detail first, and then we'll actually apply it in WordPress. So we'll talk a little theory and then we'll do a little practice. So copy that blogging WordPress checklist to your desktop. Double click it from your desktop and then we'll discuss it. Did everyone find that file? Does anyone need a little help bringing it up? Okay, so it's when you go in there, you're going to see Campus Blogging, and inside you'll see a file called Campus Blogging WordPress Checklist. So if we look at the three sections of this sheet, there's one called planning, writing, and promoting. Everything you need to think about for writing long-term blog content. Now this is focusing a little bit more on long-term blog content, WordPress. Most of these things don't quite apply to Tumblr, because as we'll see, Tumblr is the short-form blog platform, that it is much more like a social network than a full classic blog. So we will be able to apply some of these things to Tumblr, but right now we're focused on WordPress. So there's the section on planning. This is what you need to do before you start writing. Some basic things that you might not need to do every time, but you plan them and you think about them early on. So I've got decide on a hosted versus self-hosted solution. We talked about this where we said we can create a free blog account at WordPress.com, but it's going to be better to get the one that you purchase at Bluehost or GoDaddy or wherever. So the first step is deciding, are you going to do the free version or the paid version? Are you going to get it on your own server, so victor.com/blog, or are you going to get victor.wordpress.com, victor.tumblr.com? So that's your first point to figure out. Hosted versus self-hosted. In my opinion and my recommendation, you want the self-hosted. You want the one that you're paying for, because you get more control, more features, more power. Number two, develop a series concept. Well, we talked about this on the very first day. What can you blog about in the long term? A blog should entice people to come back to your site time after time. Plan content that you would be happy to write about. So people that start to blog for the first time maybe have a lot of ideas and a lot of energy, and then you get at it and you start to do it for a few weeks or months, maybe even years, and then eventually maybe you get burnt out. Because what am I going to write about again this month, or this week, or this day? So if you've got a concept like we talked about, you know, people volunteered their website concepts and we put some ideas together. A lot of people had ideas, you know, that I didn't have either. You gave each other ideas. So if you've got a concept of what to write about in the long term, that should hopefully help prevent the writer's block. In addition to a concept, well, we want variety. Within your niche of expertise, plan on writing on a variety of related topics. Instead of always writing about one subject, plan on writing on 2 to 3 related ones. So I've got Victor's Bakery, and maybe my series is I'm going to give my recipe of the month. Well, only writing about my recipe of the month for a whole year or 2 years, I'm going to possibly run out of content. I'm going to get bored of it. My readers might get bored of it. So as tangential and variety, I could also write an article about the employees, you know, the baker of the quarter. I could write about the traditional, you know, the story behind a particular baked good, not exactly the recipe, but the story behind it. And so a variety of kinds of posts related to the series concept will also keep me from getting writer's block, hopefully, from getting bored of it, from having my users get bored. Number 4, going solo or not. Are you going to write everything yourself? Are you going to have other people in your organization write as well? Are you going to have ghostwriters, guest writers, paid writers? So maybe, yes, you're going to write it all yourself. You've got plenty of ideas and time. Well, maybe you've got to run your business and do the payroll and bake the cookies and everything, and then you've got to also write. Well, if you have other people that can write with you or for you, that might be useful to you. And this is a whole can of worms, because then I think the question was asked on a previous day, well, how do you get people to write for you if they don't know your company? They won't know it as deeply as you or as passionate as you. That is true. You are going to need to spend the time to find the appropriate, for example, ghostwriters. Let's say, so a ghostwriter is someone that writes for you, but they're not really credited. They're not really known that they wrote for you. And that could either be for paid or service to service or, you know, other arrangement. Maybe you're going to give them a free pie every month for them to write something in your bakery blog. So you have to figure out, you have to see writing samples. You have to see writing samples. You have to read their work, maybe give them a test.
I'm just thinking about for your business, if you do have a bakery, you could also have a guest chef do something about something.
Yeah, you can have other guest writers.
Your monthly guest chef.
Like I got right there, the guest writers. This is just trying to figure out, am I going to do it all myself or am I going to get other people involved? So ghost writers, guest writers, paid writers. So maybe let's go through different scenarios. So let's say I've got this bakery and I've got a couple of bakers in my kitchen. Well, I'm going to be mostly the one writing something, but maybe I'm going to ask my bakers as well to contribute, maybe once a month or once a quarter or whatever. I'm going to have other people also writing for me. The problem with that would be, well, they're really good in the kitchen. How well are they on the keyboard? They might not be that good at it. They might not write very well, and you're going to have to proofread everything. They might hate it more than you to write. Their ideas might taper out faster than you. So there's a lot of things to consider there. Other people in my own organization helping to write. Well, if Donna in accounting is already doing accounting, she's not going to have the will to also get creative and write something on that regular basis. So don't just put another job description on someone else that they've already got plenty to work with.
Mr. Parker, I noticed while doing research on various subjects that sometimes the very same article is appearing under a different website. Does that mean they have many different websites or blogs with different names, or does it just mean that people are borrowing information?
That's a big answer to a simple question, because it could be paid writers. What I was going to get to was that You could hire paid writers. You could get professional bloggers to write for you. Now, the problem with that could be that they kind of repurpose their blog posts for a bunch of sites. Maybe they've got 10 core articles that they just change slightly and sell it to that blog and to this blog and to that blog. And that's not so good. If you have duplicate content, if there's duplicate content on different websites, that might be negative. If your blog post is the same as someone else's, the search engines are crawling the web 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year. They're going to run into eventually that this article, this page, looks exactly the same as this page, just that it's on victor.com and over here it's on janet.com. So the search engines will penalize you both. And maybe you didn't know. Maybe you didn't know that your paid writer is doing that. That's why you want to check. What are their samples? What have they written before? References. So when you see duplicate content throughout there, it may or may not be negative for the parties involved. It may be a copy of someone else's work that they don't know about, and it could help their SEO. So paid writers could work, but it could be negative as well. Yes?
So can you help me understand the concept of why you would use a ghostwriter, but why? Well, I was in a business meeting the other day, and it was suggested for writing articles. It came up. What would be the benefit of someone not catching your name? Like, can you help me understand that scenario?
Sure. It's just someone that's trying to get a job as a writer to get their skills sharpened. Maybe they don't need the glory at the moment, but they need the resume and the experience and such. Now, probably they're not going to be completely anonymous as a ghostwriter. Maybe there is a stipulation in the contract about, okay, your name, you will not get a byline. Your name will not be attached directly to the blog post, but you can use it as resume samples when you're trying to get hired. It's going to depend on a case-by-case basis. So some ghostwriters might be completely anonymous, and some might have some leeway to show that they've written something. Maybe only, you know, during a hiring process, not to put it on my resume on LinkedIn that says, I wrote this, this, and this. Well, why isn't your name on it? So for the ghostwriter, those are, could be some benefits. For the money, you know, to build a portfolio of work, for those hiring a ghostwriter, it could be, well, you know, I'm running my business, and I don't want to also write my blog posts, I'll hire someone, but I still want to claim that I wrote it.
And you can do that?
Yeah, it's all in the contract. All of this stuff often is related to a contract. So if you have it all written down, then you're the most protected. Yes?
Who's the best? Like, where do you find ghostwriters?
Well, off the top of my head, unfortunately, I don't have any like direct website I can direct you to, but we can quickly look up on Yahoo or Google or whatever, you know, hire a ghostwriter. Maybe to be more specific, hire a ghostwriter for, and then the name of or the topic that you're trying to write for. So I'm sure there's websites out there that are like, you know, a hub for people to go and sell themselves as ghostwriters. Unfortunately, off the top of my head, I don't have one, but we can look one up.
Yeah, there's also a book with a list of writers, the writer's reference guide.
A book? How often is it published?
No, because I've only seen it a couple of times. Places like Barnes & Noble, but I'm sure online.
Yeah, so the problem with a book is that it goes out of date. So it might be a good starting point to get one of these like author directory books or whatever they're called, but they may go out of date. Maybe there's an online version of it so we can stay current. So those are some concerns to address before you write in the planning stage. And once these things are addressed, then the next one should fall into place. So any other questions on this first section?
So, like, if you wanted to start a book, could you already have, before you get going, some already written out, that you could plug in, you know, like, some things, so you're not, like, sitting and trying to come up with a new original thing every time?
It would be helpful that you do have some content ready to publish, because the next point here under writing is frequency. So, If we're just starting from scratch right now, and maybe we want to sit down and write a bunch of articles and then put it online, that'll work. Eventually, you're going to run out of that store of pre-written articles, and you're going to get to eventually anyway having to write on a regular basis. So if you have them ready beforehand, fine. If you don't, fine. You're still going to create them as necessary. In the section under writing, it's many more points here. And we'll do this together, of course. But we've got frequency. No matter your schedule, the important thing is to blog consistently. Start off with a once-a-month blog if you're not used to blogging. Once a week is better. Once a day is best. So the point of being so frequent, of putting out new blog posts so frequently, is that that's going to help put out your name to the web. Google is going to start finding you. Yahoo's going to start finding you. Bing is going to start finding you. If you've only got your website, that's only one thing for the search engines to know about you. But if you've got various blog posts that are updated on a regular basis, if you're also sharing, and it's a point later on here, on social media, the search engines will find you. We don't quite talk about it in this class, but one little tangent that I can mention is about the concept of Google Alerts. If you haven't heard what those are, is you can log on to, I don't know the website address, but you can go to Google and look up Google Alerts and set up these sort of little triggers that you will get an email whenever a certain keyword is found by Google. So I can set up a keyword whenever there's a brand new article on Google about, cat blogs. That will then let me know there's a brand new cat blog out there. What are they writing? Are they a direct competitor to me? What can I learn from them? So if I've got a product, if I've got Victor's Bakery, and I want to know, is Victor's Bakery appearing on Google search? I set up a Google alert, and whenever Google finds a reference to Victor's Bakery, it'll send me an email with the link to that post, that article. That'll show how popular my blogs are if Google is finding them. Because I'm saying here, what's best is once a day, which is very difficult for one person to do. That takes us back to the previous one. Well, do you have ghost writers, guest writers, paid writers? And if you're new to blogging, once a month is a good starting point, although everyone's going to tell you, you need to blog once a week. Yes, but for a beginner, that's pretty overwhelming. At least once a month to get your feet wet, and then increase the frequency. But the point is that if you haven't updated your blog in 6 months, it's way too long. In 3 months, it's still a bit too long. So whatever schedule, once a month, as long as you're putting out content, original content, every once in a while. People then always ask, okay, well, how much am I going to write? This is going to vary, and you're going to get many articles or tutorials that tell you, make sure your article is 500 words every day. That's a lot of content. As a beginner, 100 words per blog post. So 100 words once a month. That is completely doable. WordPress will give you a counter at the bottom of the page that will show you your word count, and you're going to see you're going to fill up 100 words pretty quickly. So 100 words is good to start off with. 300 is better. So even more than that is a little better, because then the search engines see your content, understand what your site is about, rank you higher, and hopefully get you found the more content you have out there. Once you're doing this on a regular basis, you can of course vary it 100 to 300 to 500. But think about this. If you have a 500-word blog post, that could be divided up into a few pieces, a few chunks, and have part one, part two, part three. And that 500 words, let's say 600 just to round it off. It's too early for math. Let's say 600 words. So that's, I'm going to publish 100 words 1 month, 100 words the next month, 100 words the third month. And I've got 3 months of content there at 100 words per post. And then I can string them together as part one, part two, part three, and link them all together pretty easily in WordPress. We'll see how to do that. And that's going to help you solve your frequency. So sure, write 500 words, write 1,000 words. But you could divide up those 1,000 words into 10 posts. That's 10 months. Or, you know, 200 words, that's 5 months of content. And I mentioned it briefly, and we'll look at it again, about scheduling posts. We can spend a weekend writing 500 words, 1,000 words, and divide up those 1,000 words into 200-word chunks and set 200 words to publish this month, 200 words next month, 200 words next month, and so forth. And you've got 5 months of content. The title, well, it does apply, unfortunately. You can judge a book by its cover. You can judge a blog post by its title. So on our title, we want a short, memorable, and direct title. Think in terms of content that people need and want to read. My review on the Toshiba T75, a winner. So this has the keyword review and the product, Toshiba T75. So people would be searching for that online, Toshiba T75 reviews, T75 testimonials. So I have to think about what keywords might people search for, and can I think about adding those keywords to my title? But I'm not going to write a 100-character title, because that's going to be cut off at a certain point. Google and Bing and Yahoo will not show you a 100-word title on their results. They're going to show you about 40 to 50 characters. So that's what I'm saying about it being short. It's direct about what is this post about. Memorable. This is also an art and a science, ties into a lot of SEO concepts. When we write something a little later, we'll try to brainstorm on it. But think about in terms of what people would be searching for, what people would want to find. We're also going to see about adding a description, because on a search result page, you know, obviously Google is the most famous search engine. It's not the only one. The second most famous is Bing.com. You may have never heard of it. You may have never used it, but it is the second biggest one. It's got about 20% traffic globally. That's hundreds of millions, if not billions, of searches at only 20%. But Bing is just another search engine. Bing is the common search engine on some phones. Bing is the common search engine now, like on the iPhone and such. Maybe you never realized it, you just use it. It is also the common search engine, the built-in search engine to a Windows computer. When someone buys a brand new computer at Fry's or whatever, Walmart, and it's a Windows computer, it's going to have Bing. Boehner to resign. Wow. Question.
Yeah, question. Bing and Yahoo, do I have to still worry about the different search engines there?
Well, the thing about Yahoo is that it actually gets many of its results from Bing now. So if you optimize or you think about how Bing works, its results are going to trickle down to Yahoo anyway.
So work on Bing.
Yeah, Google and Bing. And then you'll really be covering all the bases. So if I'm looking for, Adobe brackets reviews, or tutorial. So notice the results are going to be, well, there's some YouTube videos, mostly videos. There's an article, building your first brackets extension. So this top result is very crowded. It's crowded with ads, it's crowded with tutorials, blog posts, so I'm gonna need to try hard to get found for Adobe brackets tutorial. Everyone's trying to get found by that keyword. So the art and the science of SEO is, well, okay, I'm not getting the exact results here. What I'm going to do is be more specific. Nowadays, people are more specific. People are more specific when they search. Think about how you search. If you only use basic keywords? Probably not. You probably nowadays search for a little bit more of detail, so maybe how to build an app with Adobe brackets. So we've got here, create your first app with brackets, how to build a brackets app shell in Windows, how to build the brackets app shell on Mac, create your first app with brackets, etc. So something like that would be more of a title that I'm going to use, you know, more specific. This is what people are searching for. This requires also, in a sense, this is also a bit of what should be under the planning stage, but you're not going to be able to always plan very, very far ahead. You're going to start writing your blog post, then it's time to think of a title, and then you start to do the research. Well, what are people searching for? How can my title hit those keywords that people are looking for?
Mr. Campos, is WordPress already in the cloud? So when you, I mean, I'm just curious because I just bought an application for Office application, and even now they give you an option to go on their cloud system, and I'm just curious whether one should opt in or out of that. Is it safer?
Well, that sounds like two different questions. WordPress is in the cloud. WordPress is software that gets installed to a server, so technically it's on the cloud. If you had downloaded, for example, the classic Microsoft Word and you installed it on your computer, it's not in the cloud. It's only on your computer. But now Microsoft sells Office 365, which is their cloud version.
That's the one that I—
yeah, so this really is a personal thing to decide upon. Much more stuff is moving to the cloud, moving online. There's pros and cons, of course. It's very convenient. I'm using it. I'm putting my documents up on my account, up on my Office 365 account. That means I can access them from any computer. Very convenient. And I try to have a very good password and practice other good cybersecurity. The downside, of course, could be, well, you're going to have maybe hackers trying to break into these things, and we've seen it happen. We've seen the celebrity photos being stolen. We've seen the target credit card information being stolen. The more of the stuff online that there is, the more there is an enticement of someone to steal it. But then it's also up to the companies to harden their security, and some of it is also on us that we have a good password and all of that. So it's really up to you to decide if you want to use your stuff in the cloud. But by the default, when we use WordPress, it is a cloud-based service because it has to be installed on a server. We'll talk about images. People always ask, can I use any image I find online? The short answer is no. The long answer is no. Because we don't know what sort of royalties that have to be paid. We don't know if this is copyrighted. We don't know if this is trademarked. We don't know what protections there are. Well, that's annoying for us. I found a perfect picture that will really work on my blog post. Well, you could use it if you ask for permission. They might grant you permission. Maybe someone's putting out that photo just because they want to put the photos online and want to get a little bit of internet fame, and sure, use my photo. But I'm really going to say be very careful about using other people's content, other people's sounds or pictures or text. You don't know if the original creator of those things will really, really be a copyright stickler or not. So you don't want to search simply on Google funny pictures of cats to put a picture of a cat on my blog post. You're not going to do that unless you're also searching with the keyword royalty-free or public domain, or I forgot to put here, but stock image. Royalty-free, public domain, stock image. Those three keywords, if you put that along with what you need to find online, will hopefully find you results that are okay for you to use. Royalty-free public domain and stock images. Well, to avoid all of that, because maybe even if you search for those, it's so easy to be run astray from the search engines. It happened to my mother the other day. She was trying to buy something on Amazon, I said, yeah, you can buy things on Amazon. So she went to Amazon, she searched, and then at the very end, there were the sponsored links. She followed one of those sponsored links, and suddenly she's on another website, and she says, well, I'm trying to buy this, but it's hard. And I said, you're not even on Amazon anymore. So be careful what you're doing with your searches. So Pixabay.com, we'll look at it together later, but Pixabay.com is a website all about full of royalty-free images, full of images that are high quality, and by that I mean they're even print quality. You can download some great pictures at Pixabay to print as big as a poster to have in your restaurant, let's say. It's okay. This is one of many places where you can go to look that up. Now, you're not going to find thousands and thousands of thousands of results. If I do a search on Bing for cat pictures, I'm going to find a billion of them. If I search cat pictures on Pixabay, I might only find 5,000. Well, possibly in those 5,000, I'll find what I'm looking for. Not the 5 billion or 5 million from Google, but I'll find something. And honestly, I use that all the time. On the recent blog posts that I've written for my company, I've gone there, I've looked up a few, and I found it, and I put it up there. Yes, if I found it, someone else might find it and use it too. So then the long answer is, okay, don't use any stock images. Don't use other people's images. Shoot your own. You've got a camera. A lot of us have a smartphone, and these cameras usually are pretty good. Take your own photos. Make your own graphics. Use clip art or whatever, but just something interesting. Choose images that relate to the topic, your own original images or stock images. Because a wall of text is boring. Even if you've got the best information there, at least one picture will help break up the monotony of the text, will give readers visual interest. When we do this together, this will make more sense. On a technical level, make sure your file names are meaningful and you've added all the text. So if you take a photo with your camera, probably it's going to be called the file name itself. It's something like DSC02587.jpg. Or if I take it on my phone, it's labeled WP2015-09-25001. The file names straight from your digital camera are gibberish, and they're not going to help you when you put them online. The search engines look at your file names. The search engines look at everything about your site. So if your picture is still called picture 00278, that's not going to be as helpful to you SEO-wise as Family Reunion 1995. So when we do this, we'll see. Make sure your file names also have meaningful names and keywords. And then we'll talk about alt text. Headings. This particular handout that I have for you here also follows some of these examples of what you should do for blogging, but here's another concrete one under headings. So I gave you a syllabus, and the syllabus is a bunch of text, but it's divided into sections. There's a section that talks about course information, student learning outcomes, recommendations. So there's sections. These sections are divided by headings. This bold text divides this section from this section, and so forth. We want to do something similar when we blog. We might have 500 words, 300 words on our article, but we want to see what can we divide. How can we put in a heading to divide this thought with that thought? I'm not saying put one before each paragraph. This is also kind of overkill. But maybe like this one on my page 2. I've got one here to talk about what the syllabus changes are, and here, which is the actual calendar. So can I write at least one heading to divide up my articles logically? The point of that is that it's going to be easier for people to read. Maybe you didn't read my syllabus from start to top, from top to bottom. Maybe you jumped directly about what are the learning outcomes, and that's fine. Studies are showing that people have shorter and shorter attention spans, especially online. So if you cater to that by having signposts throughout your articles to guide people, read this, people will read more of your article than one huge paragraph. The search engines also like this. because then you've taken the time to craft a more professional blog post, and you've delineated the different areas of the post and these headings. Google looks at those headings, looks at the text of your headings, and applies extra meaning and weight and importance to those. Yes? It's going to be very important for SEO to break that habit. You do want to, as we'll see in WordPress, to choose to label something as a heading, not to make it bold and big and red. That has no meaning. What has meaning is to choose the style, heading one, heading two. So it'll be
for search engine, basically, right? Because when you print it out, it looks like a bigger font, right? But, all right.
Yeah. So it has two purposes: one, that it should look good for the user reading it, and the other is that it should be meaningful to the search engines. So if we simply make it bold and red and such, that doesn't have the meaning that the search engines are looking for.
How large of a heading are we talking about?
It's irrelevant. It's just that it is marked as a heading, as we'll see how to do in WordPress, and how large will just depend on the layout of your site. But that it is marked as a heading one or two and such, that's the important part. Yes?
I can answer that. You said something like family reunion 2015, I think that's a new name.
Mm-hmm.
How significant would you be including the name of a company, our location, like, because family reunion 2015, it worldwide like Google, like, I'm not sure, I mean, that's...
Yeah, that was a partially incomplete answer. It would have been better Johnson Family Reunion 2015, you know, to be more specific, whose family reunion. But still, that's much better than simply IMG0078. So you don't have to go overboard about putting in all your keywords into the file names, because you're probably going to work with dozens of files. So to craft every single one of those, you know, with 20 keywords into them, that's overkill. But a meaningful file name that explains in general what it is going to be helpful. When we get to this part, however, the alt text will be more helpful. That's
so
where we would write more detail.
Like for example, at a restaurant that you work with, like, are you putting like the city, you know?
No, usually what we're doing is we're putting the name of the restaurant, dash, and then a couple of words about what's in the picture. So Texcoco dash cheese quesadilla.jpg. We're going to have more than one cheese quesadilla, most likely. So that would be okay to reuse that file name or change it up a little bit, because maybe this is a cheese quesadilla on sale. So again, I'm just putting in these keywords that help me little by little, piece by piece, with my SEO.
I was just thinking, like, for example, like, I haven't been to that restaurant. So I was thinking, like, is it better to say cheese quesadilla in San Diego?
Yeah, but I'm not going to be relying just on the file names of my pictures really to get found. It's the totality of it all. As the search engines see that you've done this and this and this and that, that helps you rank, not just to really stress on the file names of my pictures.
Okay.
But it does help.
So, Mr. Kemp, are you saying that search engines... I can't even wrap my mind around what that system is like, but are they picking up everything that's in your content? Like, they're looking at words, they're looking at the words in your headings, the words on your photos,
yes,
everything.
They are looking at everything. That's what they're designed to do, to look at a website and understand everything about the website, so that when someone searches how to build an app with Adobe brackets, if I've got those keywords throughout my site, that will possibly then rank me higher than my competitors that don't, that just have an article called Adobe brackets, that I'm writing about all of these keywords. Yeah, the search engines, they just analyze your site completely, and everything about it are signals to rank you above your competitors.
Who ones, the search engines, is it WordPress?
Google, Bing, Yahoo, AltaVista.
So they're all, they all have their own.
Yeah, their own algorithms, their own system to rank the results. So then we've got lists, bullet points or numbered lists. I've got that on my syllabus also. There's a section here, student learning outcomes. Bullet point 1, 2, 3, etc. So bullet points. They're useful because they create bite-sized pieces of content that people can consume easier. Your title, your title might derive from the type of list. Oh, your title might derive from the type of list you've written. So the title of my blog post, the top 3 best WordPress tutorials. So I'm going to have bullet point or numbered point 1, 2, and 3. And the title of my article is the top 3 best WordPress tutorials. So I've got those keywords, WordPress and tutorials. And people will see top 3. So lists are very popular types of articles to write, and it doesn't matter the number, top 3, top 10, top 12. One of my clients is on the top, I think it's the top 37 San Diego restaurants. Why 37? I don't know. It doesn't matter the number, but lists are very popular. How many times have you read an article that was the top 5 whatever, and then by the end of it, there was another one that says the top 7 whatever, and you read that one too, and then another one, and another one. So lists, this is for people to see short pieces of information. This is almost a top list here, number 8, number 7, etc. And then it makes you jump to a particular one. Maybe you just skimmed this. Okay, headings, don't care, lists, don't care, links. Let me read that. So it's okay that you don't read everything, but you read what you cared about. And in the world of the web, that happens much more. A person might not read completely your magnum opus. They're going to jump to a particular part of what you wrote. Links. A relevant internal link to your own blog post or your own site is helpful for keeping people on your site longer. A link to an external link to someone else's blog is helpful when you're trying to get backlinks. When setting external links, remember to make them open in their own tab. So, links. I've got an article about the top 5 WordPress themes, let's say. And somewhere within that article, I also have a link to one of my other How to Install WordPress articles. So from my own article, I'm linking to another article within my site. We're going to see that WordPress allows us to do that very easily, to add links and other relevant content. And the point of someone staying and reading more on my blog is, the point of having the blog or a website in general is to accomplish some goal. Let's say I've got Victor's Bakery, and I sell cupcakes. I'm going to be blogging to make people hungry, and when they're hungry enough, perhaps after reading 5 short articles on our baked goods, then that makes them hungry enough to click on the Buy Now button. Or maybe I'm a nonprofit organization. Someone stumbled upon my site because they wanted to do some philanthropy, and they read a couple of my blog posts about how we really help people throughout the world. And then eventually, they decide to click on the Donate Now, or maybe sign up for the newsletter, or something. So they accomplish something on my site, the longer they're on my site. With internal links, I keep them longer on my site to hopefully accomplish that task. If I want to get links to my site, these are called backlinks. If I want to get backlinks, one way is for you to link to someone else's site. So this, I'm sure, has a variety of terms. I call it fishing. I'm fishing for backlinks. So when you fish, you put out bait. Maybe you catch a fish, then you eat it or release it. But here, I'm going to put a link from my blog to someone else's blog. I'm a bakery, so I wrote an article about our amazing meringue pie. And I linked to some other food blogger about something relevant about pies. So the point of that is that they will get a notification, especially if they've got a WordPress site, which is the largest blog platform. They will get a notification that says, Victor's Bakery linked to your website. Some people will see that and say, great, move on with their day, and don't care. Others will see that and say, oh, who's Victor's Bakery? they'll follow my link back to my article, and then again they might say, okay, great article, thanks, and move on with their lives. Some people will see that article, like that article, maybe comment on my article, that's helping my SEO. Maybe they're gonna tweet from their account that says, we just got written up by this website. That's great for my SEO. I'm getting traffic from their Twitter. Maybe another thing that they do is they write an article in the future and they link back to my website. That's even better for SEO. So that phishing is I'm linking to someone else's site in the hopes of that they accomplish one of those things. They read my article, they tweet about it, they link back to me. That's traffic that helps my SEO. It's like a loop. I get more traffic if I have better SEO. I improve my SEO if I have more traffic. So by linking to others, I hopefully get backlinks. Obviously, it will not always work. Let's say you link to 10 sites and one links back. Well, that's still a win. One site linked to you, little by little. We improve our SEO. And we'll see that if we link to someone else's site, we should have that open in its own tab. And we'll see how to do that in WordPress. So backlinks are actually an important signal for the search engines nowadays. What other websites are linking to your website? If there's no links to my website, the search engines say, well, how relevant is this site? No one's caring. No one's linking to it. But if the search engines see there's 10 websites linking to this website, that's better because your competitor only has 2. So then you might rank higher. Yes.
I already went over this in the first session, but I'm not quite remembering. Or maybe we're going to go over it today. So are you going to show us in WordPress how, or where it is in WordPress to make sure that the when we're linking to someone else's blog that they're notified? Because that's a choice, right?
Yes, it was one of the first things. Well, it wasn't on the first day. It was last time when we got our WordPress accounts.
Okay.
And we went to the settings. There was a setting, I think it might have been under reading, under the settings of reading. I think there was in there about notify backlinks, something like that. So it's in there.
Oh, I have, okay. I was looking across. That'd be cool. Mm-hmm. Yep. Thank you. Mm-hmm.
What comes under the heading of external links? Is that the backlinks?
External links are any links to someone else's website.
So it's two links, internal and external, and backlinks are part of external.
Yeah, that's just the term that when someone else's site links back to you, it's a backlink. Sometimes it's called an incoming link, an inbound link. It's got other names, backlinks, inlinks, inbound links, just a variety of names, but links back to your website. Organizing. Set up categories and tags, as well as author pages. Use categories as the largest organizational unit, and tags as the fine-tuned organizational units. So in Victor's Bakery, I'm going to have a category of cakes, pies, and cookies. So I'm going to write about cakes, pies, and cookies. But then I might write in detail chocolate cakes, chocolate pies, chocolate cookies, sugar-free cakes, sugar-free pies, sugar-free cookies. So you see only articles about cakes will be in this category, but when I choose a tag of chocolate, that could be a cake, it could be a pie, it could be a cookie. The point of that is that when someone is searching in my site or on Google, and they're searching for those keywords, sugar-free cookie recipe. Well, I've tagged a couple of articles on my site as sugar-free, so I could be found. Either in my page or in my site, because my site can have search, or on Bing, Yahoo, Google. Yes, well. I think tag clouds are kind of passé nowadays. They were hot several years ago, and tag clouds are just basically visual representations of your tags. You might go to a website, and in the corner there's a bunch of keywords just floating there. Some keywords are bigger than others, like maybe sugar-free is really big, and then birthday is small, and all of those are clickable. I click on sugar-free, and it shows me all the sugar-free articles. That's just a visual representation of all your tags on your site, a tag cloud. And in the old days, you know, a long time ago, 3 years ago, those were pretty hot. I don't quite see them as much anymore. So you can use them. I don't think so as much anymore, because it's the search engines really care about being organic. When you have sort of like an artificial entity of a tag cloud, like, look at all my tags, I think that has less value to the search engines rather than having the ability for someone to organically search for sugar-free cookies in your search box and finding results. Question.
So is she talking about those ones that when you click on them, they open to another page or something and it goes into the whole story behind?
No, it's more like a website. I don't know if I can pull them up because, again, they're passe. You visit a website, and in the sidebar or something, you've just got a list of tags.
Or like Wikipedia?
Kind of, but this also...
And they have bright words in blue that you can click on within the content, and then it takes you...
No, that's still just a plain old link. Here's this. These are tag clouds. So yeah, they might be simple blue links, bigger and smaller, or they might be very visually interesting. And that I might click on the word student, and it shows me all articles about students. Or you might see it like this. See, management is darker and bigger, so there's a lot of articles on management. There's very little on team. But this is just a visual representation to see all your tags. And at a certain point, it's overloading. Like, I can't even read this. So there's too many tags here, really, to work with. And even that started to look like gibberish. It looks like a QR code, almost. These look nice, but then still, like, who's going to read that? If you're going to build a tag cloud like this, which I like how they look, but as for how relevant they are, I'm not going to include these words that have, like, two hits. I will include the ones that have lots of hits or articles, but not these ones there.
So how would you organize the tags?
I wouldn't use word clouds anymore.
Right.
Tag clouds.
What other tags options do we have? Are we talking about hashtags?
No. Well, it'll make sense when we do it. Mm. Yes, behind you, yes. Okay, sure.
So I want to make sure I understand. I actually understand the purpose for SEO. But if I have a search on my WordPress site, a search box on my WordPress site, and someone searches for a word that it's not occurring in the title and it's not a category, maybe the only place it occurs is in the body of a post, is that the only way that the search engine, that the search feature on my blog will find that? Like,
no.
Let's say the word pie is not in a title or a category, but someone searches pie and that word appears in one of my blog posts.
No, it will be smart enough to search it in categories, tags, or your body text.
So the only real benefit of tag, not because it's the only thing, but the reason for tags is strictly SEO?
No, it's still also for organization, because if we use categories, we can make links on our site, manual links, that when you click on this category, it shows all of those posts. So for organization, maybe a person doesn't know that they're searching for sugar-free, but I have a category called sugar-free, and I have a link on my sidebar called sugar-free. So they click on that, and it'll show all sugar-free content.
Isn't that a category, not a tag?
I'm just saying either or. You can use categories or tags as things that you can click on that you can present to the user for them to click on to find your content. I don't quite have an example to show, but think about it in those terms. Like, I've got Victor's Bakery, and I'm going to be selling cakes, cookies, and pies. Up on my nav bar, I could have a link that is pies. Well, that's going to show me products of pies and maybe articles that I've written about pies. So it's also a way for people to find what they want on your site. Through menu items. Yes. Oh, behind you, there was someone behind you. Yes, go ahead.
I just want to know the relation from the link, categories, and tags. So I have my title, and then So my formally, if it's better for a CEO, if it's on the words, on categories, on text. So I really don't know how to.
The permalink is the address to your article. And your permalink could have keywords, but those keywords really do not tie in at all with your tags or categories. Your permalink can be anything that is not a category or tag. Or it could, your permalink could have a category and a tag built in. Sure. So just keep in mind, they're separate. Permalink is just the address to your article. Tags and categories are a way to search in your site or through Google to find the content.
Yeah, but based on your answer, I can't imply that if my permalink is like aligned with my tags and categories, I will link better or not.
Say that again?
If my permalink is linked with my, it's aligned with my categories and tags.
Sure.
Do I rank better or not?
Do you rank better?
Yes, in the search engine. So, or not. Matter if it's equal or not, it's parallel.
It doesn't matter if it's equal, but it matters if it's the right keywords. It matters that your title is what people are searching for. And maybe your title of simply cookies is too generic, but if it's how to bake the best cookies, well, it's using my tag or category, and it's also got how to. So it's kind of a mixture of everything. Question.
Yeah, is there a way to know like what are the most popular words, like on like the Twitter thing, you can see trending topics that show the most popular things that are happening, right? Is there a way to know what keywords are the most popular?
Yeah, and this is a big topic, but you can look up Google, what's it called? Google Keyword Finder or Keyword Manager? Google Keyword Tool. It's linked to their AdWords system, which is to create pay-per-click campaigns to purchase keywords to be found, but it still can be used for free for you to go in and look up, well, what keywords are popular, which ones are getting a lot of traffic, or conversely, if a certain keyword is getting too many hits, well, you're going to get drowned out. So maybe what's a related keyword that is not getting as much traffic that still will let me get found. So I search for Google Keyword Tool, but it's actually Google AdWords Keyword Planner. If you want to write that address, I never remember it, I just look it up. AdWords.google.com/keyword planner. I don't know if the capitalization matters, that's why I don't have it memorized. I just search Google Keyword Tool. I'm going to need to sign in and all of that to actually use it. But this is a way to search for keywords. And that's a whole art and science as well. But for free support, call that number. So I mentioned it briefly, and here it is as a point. Number 10, read more. On your blog page, only include a snippet of the post, perhaps an image, and the option for people to read more. On the post itself, set up a way for related posts to be visible. So if you wrote 500 words, and the full 500 words are on your homepage, that's too much. Because then you've got another article that's also 500 words, and another one that's 500. So on your homepage, now you've got a really, 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 really long homepage, because every word of your article is right on the homepage. And unfortunately, by default, that's what WordPress does. It puts your whole article on the home page, all the words, all the text. We will see that we can use the read more option, also known as continue reading, so that it only shows a preview text. I can show you that concretely on any one of these clients. On Elsa's, so this jewelry designer client that we have on her blog, she writes this one herself, but she likes to write and take photos. So there is a little bit of text, a picture, read more. If they then choose to read this, if this really entices you, well, what is the snake jewelry? Then you can click on that, and then the full article with lots of pictures shows up. So imagine if all of these pictures were showing up on the home page. All of her articles have a lot of pictures and text. If all of them were showing up here, you know, you wouldn't even get to the next post until you scroll so far down. So we'll see how to do that in WordPress to add just a preview and then read more. We'll also see related on the post itself, well, they've read one. I want them to read more. I want some more articles to pop up to keep them on my site, to keep them reading more, and to hopefully accomplish the goal. The goal of Elsa's site there is to, you know, show her jewelry and such and the story behind it, yes, but to sell the jewelry. So after reading this particular article and then I then feel a connection with that piece of jewelry, I will take out my credit card and buy it. So next week you'll find me here with a very, very nice snake wrist thing. So that's why you want people to read more, to stay on your blog longer to accomplish your goal. And you don't want to overwhelm them with the whole blog post at once. You want them to read more.
And the second time I've ran across the part about people staying longer on your site, is there something to that? Because, you know, I could be on the blog reading something, go to the kitchen, make a sandwich, come back. Does that mean that there's more popularity associated with staying in the blog longer? It could be...
You know, the search engines can actually keep track of that. The search engines are so powerful, they can keep track of what is the length of time someone spends on your site or per page and such. So it's amazing what they can know. The reason for this is, especially for us as bloggers, in my SEO class, we look at that. We look at, okay, Google can show me the average amount of time people spend on my page is 2 minutes. Well, for one kind of blog, 2 minutes is fine, and another 2 minutes is terrible. So if I've got, let's say, a restaurant, and they spend 2 minutes on my site, that might not be so bad because they're coming to my site to see what they want to buy, they order it, and they're done in 2 minutes. But if I've got a blog where I want people to read for a while, and they're only spending 2 minutes on my site, they're not reading enough. They're not reading anything. So not that it quite affects your SEO and such, but it's dependent on your site. What's the purpose of your site? If I've got a blog, I want people to stay longer on my site and read more. And then maybe they're on my site longer, they like my articles, maybe they're going to share on Facebook. That's going to help my SEO. But it's not an arbitrary thing that I can say, make sure people stay 7 minutes on your site. Well, 7 minutes is an eternity on a restaurant. There's no point to be 7 minutes on that site. In 2 minutes, I can order what I want and I'm done. But if they're on my site, on my blog site for 7 minutes, maybe that's just enough to read one of my latest political rants. Maybe I want them to read more.
Well, I was just wondering if the ranking increases, if Google picks up on the fact that people are really lingering and making more use of your blog than someone else.
I don't doubt that there is some importance to it, but we can't exactly know the weight of all of the factors, all of the signals. So we just want to try to optimize for as many of these signals as we know about, but we don't know. Maybe deep down secretly, Google does care that someone is on your site 7 minutes, which wouldn't make sense because 7 minutes on my blog site is relevant, but 7 minutes on my restaurant site is not quite. But who knows? They might change the algorithm later and make it much more obvious. So let's say we've planned the blog, we've written the blog post, then we get to we have to unfortunately then shatter the classic saying, no, if you build it, they will not come. You need to also promote it. So Kevin Costner would have gotten more people to visit the game. If you don't know what I'm talking about, never mind. But if you promote it, if he had promoted that, he would have gotten more people there. Same thing with your site. You wrote this article and it's amazing, but does anyone know about it? When you start off with no readers, well, it's going to be very hard for you to get more readers without a little promotion. And I don't mean promotion about spending money for views or hits and such, although you can do that. Usually in most of my classes, we talk about the free stuff as much as possible. So here's how some simple ways to promote, which I'll show you how, of course, a little later. Social for them and social for you. Make sure your readers can easily share to Facebook, Twitter, etc. on their profiles. If your content is good enough, people will want their friends to see, thus turning them into advertisers for you. So I wrote an article, the top three WordPress plugins. I want buttons on my article there for them to tweet about it, for them to put it on Facebook, for them to share it on LinkedIn. I want them to be able to share my stuff to their social networks easily, and they're becoming advertisers for me. I didn't pay anyone, it was a good article, they liked it, they shared it on Facebook. Now more people can see it, giving me more traffic. WordPress lets us do that very easily. We talked about it last week inside of the settings publicize section, I believe. There was a spot in there to select. Let people share on Facebook, let them share on Twitter, and the more button. So that's very easy to do, and you should do it. Let people share on social media easily. They're going to be advertisers for you. Conversely, social for you. Share your content on your relevant social media channels. Share a link to your blog post on your personal LinkedIn, or from the company Twitter, or your Instagram, etc. So I wrote this, and my company also has a Facebook page, so we'll post it on our Facebook. We've also got a LinkedIn, or I've got a personal LinkedIn, and I'll post it there. I'll say, look at what I wrote, everyone. So I'm getting perhaps more traffic from also advertising myself on my social media channels, the article. Then someone on LinkedIn read it, they liked it, they followed the link, maybe they reshared my LinkedIn post, and now their followers, their connections saw my link more, giving me more traffic. So always let people share on their social media, and always you, don't forget to share on your social media. And on that settings screen of WordPress Publicize, it also had at the top there, connect your Facebook, connect your Twitter, connect your Google+, so that I don't forget. As soon as I publish, it'll go to those networks to give me more traffic. Comments. I believe comments are in a transition phase, so this may change at some point. Allowing people to comment on your posts could help generate more traffic, but you have to remember to moderate those comments. So comments can quickly devolve into flame wars and insults and spam and all of that, unless someone is keeping track of it all and deleting the negative things and putting the spammers in the rubbish bin. If you're not moderating it manually, at the very least, turn on the option in WordPress to do it automatic, which works pretty well, but things will still get through the net. Computers are still not smart enough to know all examples of spam. I've seen the evolution of these spam messages. I've seen these spam bots. At first they were so obvious that I see this post that is this comment that itself is 100 words long, and it's full of spam links, so easily those are identifiable. I've seen them evolve to get more insidious in that the first sentence sounds like a great blog post, I learned a lot, and then the rest of it is all spam. That tricks people also because they only read the first sentence, their ego is boosted, and they let the spam through. And then they're really getting tricky, like related. This is not a blog post, but I got an email. And I almost fell for it, but I got an email that said the subject line, you know, RE, regarding. So regarding your website proposal. So I'm like, yeah, we do website proposals. So I opened up the message, and then the rest was spam. So the spammers are getting good at tricking us.
What exactly are you saying that it had nothing to do with your company if they were doing their own advertising?
They were just trying to entice me into buying their service or linking or clicking on their link by saying something that I thought was real.
And related to your business.
Yeah. So I don't know then if eventually, I don't know how important these, I don't know how important comments are to the search engines. And I don't know how less important or more important they'll get. because of the rise of social media. On social media, we can start conversations, go viral, and all of that. As for comments, those are kind of a bit of a remnant of a bygone era. You're still going to find plenty of websites out there for you to comment, but I'm seeing more websites with either very few comments because so many have to be deleted that are negative, or once in a while now I'm starting to see websites with no comment abilities, but it says follow us on Twitter. So okay, we're passing on the ability to comment to social media, and the search engines like social media. And that has its pros and cons, because if you start a conversation of your website or your blog on Twitter, for example, Twitter is very, very, very open-ended. Someone could hijack your hashtag, someone could repurpose your hashtag, someone could bend the conversation to something negative, and there's no way for you to stop that. If you started a conversation on Facebook or Google Plus, you do have more control. On Google Plus and Facebook, you are able to go and delete the negative messages. You are able to mute and block people. Twitter is much more open-ended, much more Wild West. There's pros and cons about that. And finally, guest blogging. Offer to blog on other people's relevant sites. Add your expertise to their site. Your author page should have links back to your own blog or social media, thus driving traffic to you. As you become more well-known in your niche, this will help your SEO. So again, if you're only doing things on your own website, that's only a piece of the puzzle. If you're also blogging on other people's websites, if I go find another website about food blogging and I write an article there for them, if I become a guest blogger for them, yes, I'm helping their site because now they have content and traffic, but I'm helping myself because, look at this, in investorjunkie.com. This is an investing site, if I can spell it right, InvestorJunkie. There's articles they have a group of people writing articles. Like this one is written by Kevin Mercadante. I can click on his link and then it pulls up the author page. So this is a page about him where it's showing the other blog posts he wrote. So this is helping the Investor Junkie website, but he's helping himself because then he's got at the top here info about himself, a link to his own website, a link to his own Twitter and Google Plus. So people that are visiting this website could further then go look who wrote this article and read more, or go to, I'm gonna go to his website and learn more about personal finance out of yourrut.com. I just gave him traffic right there. So that's one reason to become a guest blogger on someone else's site.
And he also had a Google profile too.
Uh-huh.
How did he get?
You just go to Google and create a Google Plus account. So links back to his other content. That's why you want to guest blog for someone else, because then more traffic back to you, in theory. This is going to be a way of promoting then, promoting your site, not individual articles, but the whole site itself. Because WordPress also allows multiple people to have access to the site. You can get other guest bloggers, and then they can fill out their author page. And on that author page, links back to their site. And we want that for our site. Obviously, well, I'm already running my business, and I'm already running social media, and I'm already doing my blog, and now I'm going to go guest blog. You know, people ask me these sorts of things incredulously, and the answer is yes. If you want to get more traffic, more hits, more sales, you have to put work into it. It doesn't happen automatically. I remember a couple semesters ago, someone was like questioning almost everything that I talked about. They're like, you really have to do that? The short answer eventually to that is no, don't do it. There's the door. Because you don't have to do any of this, but it's you're obviously in this class because something's not working. So I'm talking about the things in my classes that work because I teach this stuff and I do this stuff for real clients. So when people ask, do I really need to do this? No, technically you don't, but maybe you're not getting the best results that you want. So the more of this that you do, I'm not saying do every single one of these all the time, the more of these things, once you're educated, you can pick and choose, and these things little by little will help you. Question?
Just for curiosity, this is simple that you show about Kevin Recommendi. It's the same, he writes in this investor junkie, the same thing is on his personal blog. So how all this content is related? So, and then the Twitter, so it's always the same, it's a reputation.
Yeah, I would have to check. I didn't go further than that, but maybe he is writing the same articles on his own site and Investor Junkie. That's not so good because it's hurting both websites. Remember, duplicate content can hurt you. So hopefully he's not writing the exact same articles on both. A little better is that maybe he has one version of it on Investor Junkie and one version on his own site. And then, well, on his Twitter and such, it's perfectly fine then to have a link to the articles, either to his own site or to Investor Junkie. Because here it's just going to be a little snippet anyway, a little preview to go have you read it. And maybe 1 week it's a link to the version on Investor Junkie, and in 2 weeks it's a link back to his own site. That's okay. So it relates together as in, number one, avoid duplicate content. But number two, it's up to you to use it how you want. Okay, so that was the last item there. This is two pages. This is two pages of snippets of ideas. Again, you don't have.
It's just for you to know that in his blog, it's the same thing. It's I'm available to write similar content for your blog.
Oh, okay. So he's giving something away for free, and then he's having the paid part. So he's doing it right. There's a version of this article also, a little more expanded, that you can actually look on my blog, my company's blog. So if you go to pmdinteractive.com/blog, and notice how I have a blog on my site with that kind of permalink. That's much more common nowadays. So if you've got the name of your site, /blog, so if you need to set up a blog on your site, think about it doing it this way. It's a little technical to do. I'm not exactly going to show how, but that's what our lab time is for. But if you want a blog on your site, I would recommend that way. Sometimes you also see it as blog.thewebsite. It's not wrong, but really what you want is the /blog. Because when you have something like that on a technical level, this is a subdomain, and the search engines count it as different, as technically a different website. So you'll get different results of traffic from people going to pmdinteractive.com as opposed to blog.pmdinteractive. It's kind of technical. So the short answer is, if you want to add a blog to your site, try to add it like that, which means it's a subfolder instead of a subdomain. Again, if this doesn't make sense, we can talk during the lab time. But in any event, we've got here the blog checklist part 3 of 3, the blog checklist part 2 of 3, and the blog checklist part 1 of 3. It's basically this handout that I gave you, a little more expanded. And notice there are Facebook shares, Twitter shares, Google Plus shares. So this website has been getting, I mean, these articles have been getting traffic, they've been shared to social media, that's helping the SEO. You You can click to read more. Again, you only see a snippet of it. You click the picture to read more. There's the whole thing. Eye-catching picture that I got from Pixabay.com. It follows the contents of the article itself. There's a heading, bullet points or numbered points, links, internal, external, a picture, a title, the blog checklist, internal links. Here's a link back to part 1 and 2. So I keep them on my site. Then you've also got down here, read more, related. So it's going to show you. There it is, another way to see it. Read that one or read another one related. Have people themselves have a way to share. I got a like here from WordPress. Guyver 2015 liked it. I've got some shares on Facebook, Twitter, Google+. And at the moment, there's no comments, but there's the ability for people to comment, and of course, those are moderated. Anything that, any crazy thing won't show up until we say it's okay. And so on the clients that we have, we practice what we preach, and our own site, we practice what we preach, the contents of that checklist.
What would be a tag?
On this one, it's not... Like I said, you don't have to do all of those items on my checklist, so on this we're not doing it. We're not using categories or tags in an obvious way. It's all internal. But I think we can still search up here. I think how to. Yeah, so that's pulling up a couple of how to's there. So it's not visually obvious, but it is part of the search. Yes. Yes, search bars are important on our sites nowadays because our sites get more complex nowadays, how they have more content, and if we're going to be on a schedule of once a month blogging, it's going to be annoying for people on the blog to go next page, next page, next page, next page, next page to find your work. But if they have an idea of what to search for, they can search.
Is there a way to see
Yes, WordPress gives us statistics, so when we log back into our WordPress, we'll see that, and it'll tell us, this is your most popular page, these are the most popular keywords. To get even more detail, we would set up Google Analytics and Bing Webmaster Tools, and those will give us much more detail. No, we won't be setting those up in this class, that's a whole day of topics, and that's in my SEO class. But at the least, WordPress will give us some good statistics and such, but on the SEO class we set up the more powerful ones. All right, so we've been talking about a while, talking for a while now. We're about to take a break, and now you've got this blog that you can look at for other interesting, relevant things like WordPress plugins. Part two is coming soon. So notice right here, this is being divided up into parts to hopefully entice you to subscribe or keep coming back. So it's 11:05, let's take a 10-minute break. We'll be back at 11:15, and we'll go on.